Hello everybody! In today's video, I would like to share with you my review of the D-Sonic amplifier and also the reason why I went with the separate amp from the AVR. If you are interested into this topic, welcome to watch this video! Some time ago, I was reluctant to buy separate amplifier. Why? Because I was always into the sound. I was a DJ for 15 years, I was always in music, I loved the home theater topic for about 20 years. And also when I was even a kid, I was making the small discos for kids in the school, for younger kids when I was a teenager also. So I had some memory of professional amps, of professional speakers. And why I did not want separate amp? Because I already discovered, for being in the music industry for a long time, I discovered that the more equipment you have, the more things can break. So for me, going with separate amp in the beginning was like, oh, it will have more noise, it will have this sound when you turn on, you know, when you turn on the speakers, it will have more things to break, the cables, the plugs to break between it, and then you have to buy more cables, spend more money, more things to be damaged, more complication. I did not want all of this. And also the old amplifiers, I remember the professional amplifiers, like, you know, 20, 30 years ago, they had a lot of noise, background noise, they were not so high quality. And so I was also reluctant to spend a lot of money. I have seen like some very expensive amplifiers, $5,000-$10,000 or something like this. And I was, oh, why do I need it? My Yamaha is great. It can do everything what I need. But as you know already from the first video, I ordered these speakers. And first thing, they were rated to up to 2,000 watts. So my Yamaha, which has 100 something, I don't remember, 140 or something like this, and it's even two channel driven. So my Yamaha was like 10 times, even more than 10 times, 15 times less power that they need. And also these speakers dip down to 2.6 ohms. In some, because normally when you have the speaker impedance, when they write it's 4 ohm, this one is 8 ohm or something, it's not like this, that is 4 ohm all. It will have average, let's say, on 4 ohms. Sometimes also some producers don't put the right one. So these speakers, they are rated at 4 ohms, but they dip down, especially in the bass area, they dip down to 2.6 ohm. And my Yamaha amplifier was recommended only to 6 ohm, not less. So 2.6 is relatively a lot of less. It's a lot of less than it can handle. One more reason was, when I hooked up my JBL system before, and also I put some Atmos speakers, so actually I was using all the amps that Yamaha provides, which is 9 amps, for 3 in the front, 4 surrounds, so it's together it's 7, and 2 Atmos, so you can get 9 channels. So when I hooked up 9 channels and I was listening, I don't think it was even a reference level, but every movie that I watched with my wife, the Yamaha was shutting down 3-4 times, and it was very scary because usually it happened in the most action, yeah, and suddenly boom, everything shuts down, you know, the picture, the sound, everything. It's really not a nice, not a pleasant thing. And also I was thinking, the more times it shut down, the less time it will live. So I did not want to kill it, because I love this Yamaha, you know, I love, well, here, it's somewhere here behind me. So I love this receiver, and I didn't want to damage it. At that time also, I heard with the higher listening levels, like I say, it's not even the reference level, I heard that the speakers were producing really distorted sound. So it was distorted with the high levels, it was just like this going from the speakers. So I knew, okay, these speakers can cope with any listening levels, but I knew, okay, I would need also amplifier to drive them. So what were my requirements when I started looking for a separate amplifier? First thing was the power, possibly 2000 watt, because this is what Jeff is recommending for this JTR towers, 2000 watt, so it should be 2000 watt, which is already very, very hard to cope. No, there is not so many, not professional amplifiers, like home theater amplifiers, which can produce 2000 watts. Another thing, the amplifier should have the ability to have speakers that dip down to 2.6 ohm. This was very important thing I learned later. I will come back to this in this video. Another thing was that it will be not hot, because I heard that class A amps, for example, they get like a heater, and I live in Thailand. Come on, I spent fortune here on the air condition, so I don't want some heater in my room, you know, that produces like 1,000, 2,000 watt of heat. So I wanted it to be cold. Then I learned that D-class amps is the way to go, that if you want the cold amplifier, even AB are quite quite hot, and sometimes they can get very, very hot and produce a lot of heat, and they are not so much efficient. Another thing, I wanted this amplifier to have XLR inputs, because I knew XLR cables, balanced cables, are much better than normal RCA cables, normal change cables. So I wanted the XLR. I wanted good warranty also for reliability, because I live in the tropical island here. There is no shops or service, and also in Thailand there is not so many, I think, professional service. Not for sure, not here. So I have to drive to Bangkok or fly to Bangkok with it, or something like this. And especially if I order, because I noticed that most of the equipment that I was interested in is from America, is from another countries. They don't have the good dealership in Thailand. So I knew that if something breaks and I have to ship it back to America, and then somebody ship it back to here, paying customs all the way, taxes, shipping costs, it will don't make any sense. So I wanted some amplifier that have good warranty, but even if something breaks, that this amplifier is like quite easy to replace this part by myself. This is what I was looking for also. Another thing was low noise. I don't like noise. This is really, I have trauma from, like I told you, making the school disco for kids. And I remember always these amplifiers make like a lot of noise, and I have quite good ears. Still, I think, I hope so, I have quite good ears, so it will just annoy me. This noise will annoy me. I do not want any noise. My Yamaha is dead silent when I used its amplifiers, so I wanted to keep this keep the noise levels very, very low. Another thing was, which I learned later, was damping factor, which is the ability to the amplifier to control the speakers, because normally, when you have the speaker and the amplifier, yeah, and they work together, so the amplifier is putting some current through the speaker, and then the coil in the speaker with the magnet, it's making a motor which is moving the membrane like this, yeah? So if the speaker is moving, and let's say the speaker is, you know, it has some suspension, and when the amplifier, let's say, stops, and then the speaker can move a little bit still, yeah? Because it's just normal laws of physics. So then the speaker will start to generate power back to the amplifier. And just if you want to stop it, and then the speakers is like really good control. So I wanted also this thing, because the speakers are very, very big, not normal, not standard. And I wanted also the price not to be crazy. So what I was considering also, apart from this amp, I was considering the ATI N543NC, which has 1000 watt into 4 ohms, but I contacted the ATI and they were very nice to respond, but they told me this amp is in the bridged way, and it cannot drive the speakers. It cannot just go to 2.6 ohms, no way. I should not use it with this with these towers. I was considering also Emotiva XPA DR3, which has 600 watts in 4 ohms, but they told me the same thing, that is also in the bridge construction, and another thing that with the 95 dB speakers I could get some noise. After weeks or after months of research, I found out about clipping. Actually, even last year I had no idea what clipping is, but I was reading a lot because I wanted to know actually how much power I need for my speakers. So I learned a lot of things, how much the watts transient, for example, to the listening levels, to decibels, how many watts you need for bass speakers like this, and how many for the tweeter or the mid-range speaker, how it all looks. So I was learning, but the most important thing that I learned was about clipping, because before I was thinking I burned couple of my speakers, of my JBL speakers, because when I put loud listening levels, I heard already harsh sound from the speakers, similar to when it's when the speaker is burned, you know, like start to produce the sound, and it was not only one, but one or two or three. I was thinking I was just driving them too loud with my Yamaha, so they were two small speakers. That's why I needed something big like this. But then I found out about clipping, that actually it's not the speaker that doesn't have enough power or doesn't allow for enough power, but actually is the amplifier that can burn your speakers. So actually you will burn your speakers most of the times not when you have too strong amplifier, but when the amplifier have not enough power to cope with your listening levels, and then it will produce something which is called clipping. So normally if you have the sound signal, it will be like this, yeah, like let's say if we put the sinusoid, if you put the sinusoid, it will look like this, yeah. So it will have round edges and it will make the speaker go up and like this and like this and like this, and it will move, and the speaker is moving, so the coil is not staying in one place with the power, but actually it's moving all the time, so it's also cooling itself when it's moving. But when the amplifier don't have enough capability to produce the power that you require him to do, then the sinusoid will not start to get, you know, normally when you increase the sound, the sinusoid will just get taller. But at this time, let's say the sinusoid is hitting like a ceiling. So in the top and in the bottom of the graph, you will see that there is like a straight line in the top, a straight line in the bottom. So same if we put the sinusoid, but we just cut it in the top and in the bottom. And then it produces the DC voltage. DC voltage. And what the DC voltage is making for the speaker? It just make it move to one side, let's say in the front, and stay there for some time, and then it comes back to normal movement. So at this time when it stays, the coil can get overheated, and it's something that will burn your speaker. So this clipping is produced by the amplifier not having enough power. So after all this research, which lasted for months, I decided, being recommended by some people connected with the JTR speakers, a couple of people recommended to me to look into Disonic amps. And actually, I could not hear them because they are in America, so it's hard for me in Thailand here to hear them. But from all the specifications and the reviews that I found on AVS forum, looked like people were very satisfied with this amplifier. So I went with this one, M3a 6100 7-channel amplifier, which right now when I ordered it, it was $4,475. Plus, like I said, for two power cords, there is some additional payment, and for the rack mount, special rack mount, also you can order it for extra. Dennis was very fast with the making the order, so it was very nice, you know, the contact with Dennis, the Deacon, who is the producer of the amplifiers, was great. He was responding very fast to my emails, giving all the information, helping me with decision and everything. He also sent it very fast. Dennis get big thumbs up because it came very in a very big stiff box, very stiff cardboard inside with some foam, so it was protected really good for the transport, for shipping from another part of the world. Inside was manual, two cables, the rack mount, and the amplifier itself. It's very heavy. It is 25.4 kilograms, which is 56 pounds. It's quite long also. Like normally in the front, if you look, it have normal, quite standard size, but it's also quite long. It's 47 centimeters long. So you have to also think about it if you want to put it in some cabinet or somewhere that you will have enough space to for the length of it. So let's go to the characteristics of this amplifier. It have together 7 channels, 3 front channels, which are taking about 70% of the sound when you even listen in the 7.1.2 or 7.144, 80%, 70%, 80% of the sound will come from the front stage, so it should be the most powerful apart from the subwoofer. So it has 1,500 watts into 8 ohms and 2,200 watts into 4 ohms. So for me, perfect. Speakers with 2,000 watts and the amplifier with 2,200 watts, which is what is recommended, a little bit more power for the amplifier than the speakers can handle and that I can handle. So it have another four channels for the surround speakers, which are 800 watts into four ohms and 400 watts into 8 ohms. So together, if you count everything in 4 ohms, potentially it should generate about 10,000 watts of power. Of course, it's limited by the power supply and about my power supply here to this room, but it have something like this. Even Dennis is putting 2 power cords for this amplifier. You have to pay a little bit extra, but you will get 2 power cords. And I did not know that these cords are so thick. I think it's the thickest cord for the amplifier I've ever seen. They really look tough, you know, they really look tough. And another thing is low noise and distortion. I can tell you the idle noise from what Dennis is providing on the website with the surround channels is 55 microvolts, and here it's 110 microvolts for the front stage. But I can tell you with even these efficient speakers, 95 dB, I cannot hear almost any noise when I put the head in the front baffle of the speaker. If I put my head inside the horn, which is a lot of space, you can, you know, put a lot of people inside there to the speakers because they are crazy big. But if I put my head inside, I will hear some, you know, some slight hiss. But from when I go already, like, let's say 1 foot from the about 30, 40 centimeters from the driver itself, so like in front of the speaker, I don't hear any noise at all. And from surrounds, there is, I have to really put my head inside the speaker. So this is what I wanted, you know, it's like already 1 meter from the speaker, even half meter from the speaker, you cannot hear any noise at all. And from what I have found on the internet, this amplifier is using the Pascal modules. These are X Pro 3 Pascal modules. So it have 3 modules inside. Each one have like a big channel for this front ones. And each one also have 2 smaller channels for the surround. So together, I think there is inside 6 surround channel, but I'm using only 4 and plus 3 big. But also, this is not only Pascal modules, because they are modified by Dennis, and they have their own input stage made by Dennis, and everything is a little bit modified. But from what I heard, this D-class modules are the most powerful on Earth. So that's nice. And it have a damping factor more than 1000, so it should be enough for any speakers. Signal to noise ratio is 120 dB. Then the total harmonic distortions plus noise is 0.05%. And they are stable, from what Dennis is writing, stable to 2 ohms, which is what I needed. It have a lot of protection. You know, this Pascal modules have a lot of, and also like construction that Dennis make with them, have a lot of protection. There is an input limiter, short circuit protection, DC protection of output, so it doesn't allow for clipping, under and over voltage protection, intelligent mains fuse protection, power stage overload protection, temperature protection. And what is beautiful with it, I've seen in another amps, for example, which are older construction, you have to, you know, go to the amplifier even if something goes wrong and you have to change the fuse or you have to press some switch. But this one, even if something happens, if you short by accident the cables of the speakers, which I don't recommend, beautiful thing is all these protections are automatic. So if, for example, even something happens, I don't think it can overheat. I don't know what I would have to do, because it's never gets hot, maybe a little bit warm, but even if it overheats, you just wait a little bit and it will turn on by itself. So it's service free, which for me is important, because I have it behind my acoustically transparent screen. So if there was some problem, maintenance, have to put some switch, every time I have to put out the screen, I have to, my wife have to help me, because the screen is crazy big. It have 4 meters wide in the bottom, so it's heavy also. And each time I will have to take it out the screen, move the furniture here and then plug. So I am glad that they constructed this thing like this. It have also some RFI, which is radio frequency interface, and EMI, electromagnetic interface filters at the AC input. It have both XLR and RCA, the gold plated inputs. Very nice, very tough. I've seen the XLRs are Neutrik gold plated inputs. It have very, very strong also and tough speaker outputs, which I like really. They are just nice to put the cable inside. And also it put the cable, which I told you, it can even go up to, I think it's maximum 160 volts. I don't think I will ever get to this level, but if it will hide all the actually cables inside the speaker connection. Another thing which is very nice, it's the trigger. 12 volt trigger, which works great. I will come back to it. I love it. In the standby mode, it only takes 1 to 3 watts of power. So actually it can stay turned on like this in the sleep mode with the trigger, and it will not, almost don't take any energy. Another thing is the box itself, which is like a tank, which is made from powder coated steel with the aluminum front, anodized front panel. Also, Dennis is providing a 3-year warranty for this amplifier. And like I said, I ordered 220-amp cords, which are like, one is extra. Dennis told me like in the home they are not needed, but I just wanted to have 2 thick, really nice cables, you know, going to amplifier, just to have it. And and another thing also, you can order extra some rack mounting, rack shelf, which I ordered also already. If I want to put some nice rack, probably in the future I will, then it will be already waiting for the amp. So what are my impressions about this amplifier? First thing, I connected everything. I had some old cables in the beginning, and in the beginning also I did not have this big tower, so I just connected it with my former system. It was exactly the same system as I was using for the with Yamaha. So I just put some old cables, and first thing, and I also connected with the trigger. Already with the trigger that the Yamaha amplifier will also send the signal to the Disonic to turn it on. And first thing I noticed was the sexy click click. So listen to me, this is just a nice small detail which makes your life better. I love it. When I turn on right now my system, when I turn on my Yamaha, there is first the click from the Yamaha, from the receiver itself. Then after sometimes there are very nice clicks from the relays in the Disonic, and in tick tick tick, make very nice sound, and in the end the Yamaha also turn on its own relays for the amplifiers. So it's very nice sound. I cannot describe it to you, I can just play it for you. It's something like this. It just sounds nice. It's just nice click. When you turn on, you already have a smile on your face. So when I hooked it up, of course I turn on the YPAO. I don't know even how to read it. Yamaha, come on, change this name. YPAO. Make some nice name for it. Come on, this is the system. But anyway, it's the automatic system that makes all the EQ and levels for your speakers in the beginning. So I used it. And after I put the songs that I know on the same speakers, same cables, just the amplifier was new, it was totally different from the beginning. The sound was more clean, it was more precise.
I never take anything for granted. Only a fool maybe takes things for granted. Just because it's here today, it can be gone tomorrow. And that's one thing that you never in your life ever have to worry about me. If I'll ever change towards you, because baby, I love you. Girl, I love you. Just the way you are.
There were more details in the music. Suddenly with the song, for example, which I used in the first video, I could hear the buttons on the saxophone. Like there is a sound of the saxophone, but also somebody pressing these buttons on the saxophone. I could suddenly hear it. It was not possible. I just did not notice it with Yamaha before. When somebody was playing piano, you can sometimes hear the small hammer hitting the strings in the piano. So it's all these small details that just make the sound more real to you. It just really, you feel like somebody put your head inside the saxophone or something. It's very nice detailed sound. But the biggest difference was in the dynamics of the sound, with the tight bass, with the like subjective feeling of the sound. It was so different. Before, I felt like, if I can compare the sound before, when I had all the speakers, you know, 9 speakers hooked to my Yamaha, because of the clipping of the distortion, because I was using too much power of the Yamaha, and I felt like I could compare it when I was maybe 20 years ago, and we had a Deu Nexia car. And of course this car you could use on the highway and drive 170 kilometers per hour, but the engine was on the max revs. You have to put your gas pedal to the maximum all the time, like for hours. It was loud inside, it was hot, the engine was hot, you have to just push it to the max. And this was before when I was watching movies, okay? And now it was, now I have Nissan Tiana, which have maybe 170 horsepower. But this car is awesome. And now when I drive this car and I go on the highway and I drive 170 km per hour, it don't even go to 1000 revs. So it just, the car is, you know, going, well, no problem, no problem, 170, no problem. Or I also had a muscle car at some moment, Pontiac Transam with 5.7 liter. This is the feeling, you know, like when you drive with the muscle car 150, you just don't even, you don't put the last gear, you don't push any revs, you know, it's very low, the revs of your car. You know it can go more, but you don't need to, but you just know it can go, there's no problem. If I can also compare it, you know, the dynamic range and also the dynamics of this amplifier, I can tell you, like, it's running. When you run really fast and you run to maximum of your capabilities and you can, you have no air, you tell me, please stop, I cannot run faster, it's like this. This was listening of my Yamaha before, but this one is like, okay, young gentleman, how loud would you like to go? Okay, you want some more power? No problem, here is more power. You want 500 watts more? No problem, no problem. Please just mind your ears because they can get hurt. But still, do you want more power? No problem. This is what amplifier is saying to you. Like, it doesn't even sweat. With even very loud levels, no problem at all. With driving these speakers full range, no problem at all.
Know why I didn't come. I left you by the house of fun. I don't know why I didn't
What I found out, even before the speakers arrived, when I still had my old JBL system with the Disonic, I found out that it was not my speakers being blown. It was not the lack of ability to have more loudness from my speakers. It was actually the Yamaha, which did not have enough power, because one thing is how many watts you can put on one channel and how many you can put on nine channels, because they go from one common transformer, yeah, which have its own limitations. So actually it was Yamaha clipping, it was Yamaha distorting the sound, and not my speakers, because I put the same JBL speakers to the Disonic and they could play three times louder without any distortion. So the same speakers before just could go a lot of more louder, much more louder. In the beginning, when I just first time turned on this amplifier, I had some problems, and it was nothing connected with the Disonic, but it was connected with me just being a virgin going to separates. So I had to learn all of this, you know, ground loop stuff and hum, hiss, blah blah blah, coming from the interference. This was part of the, you know, my worry in the beginning, that you add more cables, there will be more problems, more noise, blah 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 blah. So when I just connected in the beginning, I was so much sad, you know. Actually, the first after it clicked, and my first impression was not so good for the first, let's say, 1 hour, because what I heard like from coming from all the speakers, they sound like this, and I was straight, oh, ordered the amplifier. I was worried that the separates will make more problems. Now is the problem. Okay, so I started thinking, I don't know how I came up with it, but you know what was the problem? It was the problem that I have the air condition here, yeah? So some genius before, maybe years before, some genius electrician, he was thinking, okay, let's take the power from the air condition and put it to the plug for projector in the ceiling also. So they took the same line that is powering the air condition and took it together with the plug on the ceiling for the projector. So you know what was happening? The air condition, of course, which takes a lot of power, you know, and it's very old also, so it's making a lot of problems with the voltage. So it was putting this noise through the cables to my projector, then it came to my projector, then from projector through the HDMI cable it went to my Yamaha, then from my Yamaha it went through the RCA cables to my Disonic, and then in the Disonic it was making this funny noise. So it was for me very, you know, like a tough thing to find it, but in 1 hour I just, you know, plugged off the projector, boom, and suddenly the noise from the speaker stopped. So I had to learn these things connected with good power, like that you don't have interference or something. Also, when I changed, I had the cheapest, you know, like $3 RCA cables that I somewhere had at home in the beginning. So they also added some noise. So I changed them for this AudioQuest Red River cables, which I think I could buy cheaper cables also, but this one I just like how they look, you know. And I was also thinking, okay, I buy them once and I have them for many years, so let's buy some good cables first time in my life. So I bought these cables for it, and suddenly all the noise was just disappeared. I also tried to put the cables, you know, to manage them. I don't have any rack, so right now you see it's not 100% smooth here with the cables, but there is no noise at all. It was great, but had to learn it. So it's good that also when you watch this video and you hear some, for example, especially some hum, so this noise that not that noise, but it's for sure 100% something with your plugs, with the maybe the ground loop or something like this, or some devices are interfering with the line. So first you should just try put it into different plugs in different places in different rooms and try. If it disappear, it will 90% chance it will disappear also when you start to change the configuration. And how it pairs with the JTR speakers, you can see in another video that I posted, which was a review of the speakers themselves. But I gave there my impression how they work, JTR speakers with the Sonic amp. And it just worked awesome! It's awesome! It's awesome! I cannot even tell you how awesome it is. It's loud, it's clean, it's detailed, and the dynamic range is just insane. It's just amazing. I never heard something like this, that you can some parts, you know, when something happens in the movie, it can be very nice, detailed, smooth and quiet, and suddenly when it hits you, it just hits you so hard that you have to pull the volume down because you are just scared. Your ears are not accustomed to it, you know, after a couple of minutes of quite silent sound. So the dynamic range is amazing. It just gives a lot of another dimension. It's another dimension, because before, like I said in the former review of the speakers, that I think the dynamic range was like this, and now it's like this. So now the sound can be very quiet, very nice, very detailed, but sometimes when it's needed, it can hit you in the face so strong that you will just fall down from your chair. And you have to watch out also to don't stain your seats, because sometimes it can be really scary. Another thing is the soundstage is also it's great. And from what I'm feeling, with this amplifier, it's just disappearing. And this is what I think the amplifier, good amplifier, should do. It should just disappear. It should be something that you don't even know that you have in your equipment until you take it out. So this one is disappearing totally in my cinema. It's behind the acoustic transparent screen, so I don't even see it normally, even though it's nice. I like the looks of it, but sometimes when I take out the screen, only I can look at it. So normally I don't see it. It turn on by itself, it turn off by itself with the nice clicking sound which I mentioned before. There is no additional noise compared to Yamaha from it. Even I don't know, I was a little bit scared because my former speakers were much less efficient, and with this JTRs which are 95 decibels, no problem with the noise at all. And I don't need to be scared ever in my cinema that my speakers or the amplifier will be damaged to the high levels of listening. If something happens, probably the first thing damaged will be my ears, which I started to measure right now with the SPL meter and checking how loud I'm listening. But I am exactly at the reference, 105 dBs is the max I listen here. So it's okay, everything is okay here. So I am 100% satisfied with this amplifier. It's really great. It's something what I needed. I see that all of my, my worries that I had in the beginning about going to separates are just did not have any basis, because with this amp, like really, it just gives enough power that is needed for the cinema. It never lacks any power. It disappears. It works great, and I'm happy with it. So thank you. Thank you very much. I hope you are also happy with this review. I hope you like my videos. If yes, please subscribe to this channel. I hope I will develop this channel to give for you some knowledge, share my experience, to make reviews of movies, equipment, stuff, projectors, amplifiers, speakers, everything connected with the home theater. So subscribe. If you did not do yet, please put the thumbs up. Please put the big thumbs up inside the video. It will help also to YouTube to promote this video more. And see you next time. See you. Have an amazing day. Bye-bye.